Somebody. Let us be that colt that is prepared and that is available for the master's service. If I can help somebody as I pass along, please tell everybody, then my living shall not be vain. The altar is open. And if you have a need, a very special need, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice in it and be glad.
Let us great back to God crusade. so much more. He said, see my face. He says, see my face. He says, hear my voice. He says, hear my voice. He says, hear my voice, hear my voice, hear my voice. The day you hear my voice, I'm at your house. I'm calling you high. I'm calling you high. So much more. So much more. So let your heart and soul say yes.
Say yes. Oh, glory, glory, glory. Bless His holy name.
The hour has come. Like those in the upper room, as they prayed and waited for the promise of the Father, indeed the promise of the Father was fulfilled in their lives. For like a mighty rushing wind, the Holy Ghost came. We at Bronxwood International Church of God have fasted and prayed, and now we are waiting on the sovereign move of God. Back to God, because it comes at a very critical time in our nation's history. Our world and our nation are in crisis. Thus they need a church in revival. Oh Lord, revive thy work. Revive us again, Lord, as we passionately plead to you. So at this time, I want to declare this 19th annual Back to God Crusade in session for the worship of God, which is the highest exercise of the soul. Somebody praise Him. For edification, for exaltation, for comfort, for the saving of souls, for Holy Ghost baptism, for unity among the saints, for the marching together in the power of the Holy Ghost, in the name of the Father, Son, and of the blessed Holy Ghost, we are in session for God. Hallelujah. And so we praise you from the depths of our hearts. Oh, Holy Ghost, revival comes from one more time. We lift Him high. One more time. We praise Him. The name of the Lord.
But while I was sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang,
the sun grew dark with me.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I saw a new city ascending from heaven, the new Jerusalem. There where the wicked shall cease from troubling and the weary shall be at rest. No more crying there, no more dying there, no more need of hospitalization there. And we worship him and we anticipate this morning, that day, amen, when we shall see him face to face. Is anybody excited about it this morning? A tremendous joy and honor it is to have this opportunity to share with you this morning. I want to give honor to the God who has brought me safely from the Red Clay Hills of Tennessee, amen, to the Empire State of New York, and it's a joy and a privilege, amen, to be here with you in Bronxwood, amen, with your fine pastor, Pastor Corey, and his wife and family. Let's put our hands together for the man of God. So good to see so many familiar faces, amen, and to have this opportunity to share, amen, from the Word of God with you. Amen. God has been good. Amen. It seems a long time since I've had the privilege of being here with you here in Bronxwood. Haven't seen some of you from Wapikil, Philly. No, y'all didn't think I knew anything about that. Good to be here. Good to see all of you. See how God has blessed you and has been so good. Last time I was with you, you were worshiping downstairs. Amen. Upstairs, I'm sorry. Upstairs. Parking down here, that's right. Amen. But God has blessed you, and seeing that part of your vision come to pass is just a joy. Amen. And how many of you know the best is yet to come? Amen. Turn to somebody near you, telling you ain't seen nothing yet. Is yet to come. Amen. I just rejoice with you today and I'm blessed again and thank God for the wonderful vision that God has given this man of God as he continues to labor here to impact this community and to be a blessing for you. I don't know how long it has been since you have been pastor here. Amen. But we honor you today and thank God for your vision and your energy, for your stick-to-itness. Amen. For lasting dealing with us folk for all of these years. And y'all know who us folk are, right? And we're not always easy to deal with. Pastoring has been called the toughest job you'll ever love. And this man of God has withstood the storms and has been here. It's been a blessing to you. Amen. We thank God for you and what God is doing. So good also to see the Brown family back with us. Amen. We're praying for you. Continue to pray for you. That God has strengthened you. For a while, I had the opportunity of coming here to visit Sister Juliet when she was in her battle, and we texted each other for a while. One of the things that I admire is that in the midst of the bad reports and the struggle that she went through, she never talked about dying. She kept saying, when I get through this to the other side, amen, and I believe everything is going to be all right. And we bless you today, and thank God for the miracle he's wrought in your life. Amen. Praise the Lord. How do you believe in God to do something awesome in this meeting? Amen. Turn to somebody, tell them, I'm expecting. Amen. Praise God. If you're sitting next to your wife, don't get nervous. We're just spiritual. Amen. Let me apologize to those who come expecting a Palm Sunday message. I'm going to come from somewhere else this morning, but I do believe there is a word for somebody in the house. Amen. So just stay with me this morning. St. Mark chapter 4. Very familiar portion of scripture, verses 35 through 41. Amen. I'm asking you to stand for the reading and the honoring of God's word.
While you're standing, let me announce to you that I do have some DVDs and some CDs that are available there in the foyer. Stop on by the table. Amen. We have meetings from men's conferences, camp meetings, conventions, etc., etc. They come with a money-back guarantee. Amen. If you're not blessed, we will give you your money back. Is that all right? Amen. And we'll pray for you because something's wrong with you. Praise the Lord. Amen. So stop on by the table, see what we have. Beginning at verse number 35. Reads, and the same day, when evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. They had sent away the multitude. They took him even as he was in the ship. There were also with him other little ships. There arose a great storm of wind. The waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? Why is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey? Hallelujah. We want to focus our attention this morning on verse number 35. He saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And then verse 37, And there arose a great storm of wind. I want to speak to you this morning on the subject, the things in between. The things in between, and for a subtitle this morning, between point A and point B. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you again for your word. Your word is spirit and life. Thank you for your people that have gathered here this morning. We're not here by coincidence or by happenstance, but we are here because we have an appointment with your word. So speak to us today, Father, and be glorified in this house. I pray that you would speak to somebody that finds themselves between point A and point B. And be glorified now in Jesus' name. And the people of God said, Amen. 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 The things in between, or again, between point A and point B. The conception and the completion of a vision are two wonderful things that God allows we who walk with Him to experience from time to time. That is, He allows us to experience the excitement, the anticipation, and the joy of conceiving a vision of a brighter future. He gives us a plan and a picture of what it will look like. And we get it, and we began to focus on it, knowing that deep down inside that it is from God. So we began to analyze, we strategize, we plan, and we organize how it will get done. And we visualize in our mind what it will look like when it is finished. Then, of course, we began to see ourselves reaching that finish line, where there is celebration, and we anticipate the satisfaction that comes along with seeing it all come to pass. And I find that when God gives us a vision, that is often how He operates. Amen. He shows us the beginning and the end of it. He reveals to us the birthing and the completion, and the start as well as the finish. But what about those things in between? What about those things that take place between conception and maturation? Between promise and fulfillment? Between vision invisible and vision made visible? Between vision intangible and vision tangible? Between registration and graduation? What about those things that happen between point A and point B? Because if the truth be known, we as a people do not have a problem conceiving and celebrating the birth of a vision. As a matter of fact, we hear it expounded upon, and we see pictures of the desire in, and we get happy and we get excited. We dance and shout, and we'll even dare to commit ourselves publicly to supporting it and seeing it through. But then something happens to us somewhere in between. We get discouraged and we walk away in between. We allow distractions to take our eyes off the sight of a vision in between. We let the actions of people cause us to leave one ministry chasing after the myth of the greener grass of another ministry in between. We stop sowing and giving and lose out on the blessings in between. Our get up and go gets up and leaves somewhere in between, because what happens is that we discover that the things that we have to go through are more difficult than we ever dreamed it would be. So we find ourselves asking the question, God, you gave me this vision, but why did you not warn me about the things that would take place in between? Turn to your neighbor and ask them, why didn't God warn us about this? Trials that will come in between. Why did he not tell me about the things that I have to suffer in between? Why did God not warn us about this? Now, when I thought about this, I immediately thought about how God often reveals himself to us in the Word of God. Because you know what? I found it very interesting that most of the time when God shows us something about himself, he reveals to us that he is the God of the bookends of our experience. That is, he seems to show us that he is the God who is at the beginning and at the end. I mean, think about it for just a moment. He says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He says, I am the first and I am the last. In Hebrews, he tells us that he is the author, that is that which causes something to be, and the finisher, that is that which is the perfecter of our faith. He says, I am the one who brings it to an end. Amen. And we thank God for that awesome revelation of himself. Amen. We praise God that he shows us that he is the beginning and the end. And I bless him and I glorify him for that wonderful revelation. But the question that I made that it makes me want to ask is, God, I know that you are the initiator. I know that you are the ending. I know that you are the beginning. I know that you are the finisher. But what about those things that happen in
my Lord?
And then on top of that, God seems to have a sense of humor when he deals with us about our destiny and our purpose. Because what God will do is he'll come to us and he'll show us what it looks like right now. And he'll even go as far as to show us what it is going to look like in the end. But when he shows us all of those, he seems to leave out what will happen in between. And you see, I believe that the reason why God does this is because he knows how human nature is. And he knows that if he showed us all of that stuff we'd have to walk through, that most of us would just lift our hands and say, God, you need to find somebody else. I'm good right where I am. That's how he operates. He comes to Abraham and says, Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to make of you a great nation. I'm going to establish you. I'm going to bless those that bless you and curse those that curse you. Amen. I'm going to bless you. Amen. In so many wonderful ways. And I can imagine that when Abraham heard that, he said, okay, God, that sounds great. Time me up. You know, if God would have said, all right, well, you know, that's all good and fine, but in between, I'm going to cause you to go through some things. You're going to pack up all your bags, amen, in the air of Chaldees where you're all hooked up and living large and everything is wonderful. And I'm going to send you out looking for a city with half foundation whose builder and maker is God. Amen. On your journey, amen, a king is going to come and you're going to think that he's going to kill you and your wife. So you're going to lie that you even know who she is. Oh, yes, Abraham, your brother that you stepped out with, he's going to turn on you eventually. You're going to have to rescue him out of Sodom. He's going to steal. by the way, in between now and then, I'm going to cause you to be thrown into a ditch by your brothers who are jealous of you. Yeah, you're going to get out the ditch and you're going to get established in Potiphar's house. And then once you're there, and his wife is going to act strange and she's going to accuse you of raping her. So you're going to end up spending years on lockdown. And while you're down there, amen, those, you're going to help some folk get out of jail. And when they get out, they're going to forget the favor that you did them. So you're going to spend your time in jail. And so between Moses, go down and tell Pharaoh to let my people go, that they might worship me. All right, God, I can do that. All right. By the way, as you go down, after you go down there and talk to Pharaoh, he's going to listen to you part of the time, and he's going to change his mind half the time, so I'm going to have to send plagues. Yep. I'm going to kill the firstborn of Egypt on one night, and I'm going to set you free. And while you're on this way, schizophrenic Pharaoh is going to change his mind, and he's going to come after you, and he's going to try to capture you. So I'm going to have to part a Red Sea so you can walk across on dry ground. I'm going to have to drown his army behind you. Then after you get free, those same Negroes you tried to help out, and some of y'all know exactly what I'm talking about, because God gave you a vision and he gave you a dream, and he told you that he was going to do some awesome things. But in between point A and point B, you had to deal with some hell, you had to deal with some issues, you had to deal with some folk that turned against you, you had to deal with some betrayal. Oh, and you find yourself saying, God, what about those things in between? God in his infinite wisdom, he'll give us a promise, he'll give us a dream, he'll give us an ending, and even put in us an unquenchable desire to see it come to pass. Oh, but God says, listen, I cannot show you everything that's going to happen in between, but I do want you to understand that I am the God who is here and the God who is walking beside you even in those things in between. Come on and say amen. Get a little bit more on this monitor right here, please. As a matter of fact, I'm sure that that same type of question had to enter the minds of the disciples of Christ as they found themselves dealing with the problems and complexities involved in being in between launch and landing. Mark informs us that they had previously enjoyed a fruitful time of ministry with their Lord. The services were great. The crowds had gathered, offerings were probably good, all the musicians had been on time and cooperating, and everything was wonderful. And Jesus, all of a sudden, turns to his disciples and said, fellas, let us pass over to the other side. He says, we're shutting down the crusade and we're moving on. Has anybody in here ever been in a real comfortable place? A place where God was blessing you, a place where everything was wonderful, and all of a sudden Jesus shows up and says, listen, I know you're comfortable, I know that everything is fine, but it is time to transition. Let us pass over to the other side. Touch somebody and tell them it's transition time. So he says, let us pass over unto the other side. But as they embark upon their journey, somewhere between their start and their finish, somewhere between, they are confronted by a mighty storm. Verse 37 says, there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. We want to take a look at our text this morning. And we want to take a look at our text and look at the things that we must understand if we are going to make it between and deal with the things in between. The first thing that we must understand this morning, number one, if we're going to survive the things in between, is number one, that Christ is still in control during the things in between. Touch somebody and tell them God is in control. control. Scripture says that there arose a great wind and the waves beat into the ship. Now listen, I've lived in different parts of the country. God has blessed me to do that. And what I notice about every part of the country, regardless of where it is that we all face our weather issues. Yeah. Of course, here in the Northeast, we have to deal with snowstorms. Down in Florida, they have to deal with hurricanes. But there are probably two places that are the most difficult to deal with in terms of the weather issues that they have. And they would be California with its earthquakes, and Oklahoma area, what they call Tornado Alley, with its violent tornadoes. And the reason why I say that these two areas are so difficult to deal with is because of the nature of earthquakes and tornadoes. You see, here in the Northeast, when a winter storm is coming on Friday, they start talking to us about it a week before or 3 or 4 days before. So what we have is we have prior warning. You know, we can prepare ourselves. We can get ready to have to deal with the storm. When a hurricane is coming, they may not be able to predict exactly what it's going to do, but they can spot it even when it's aiming over in the West Indies, and they can chart the course so they'll have time to go out, amen, to Home Depot and board up the house and do all kinds of things. But the difference with these storms and tornadoes and earthquakes is the fact that they really happen quickly and without warning. I've been in the South when the tornadoes came, and you might get a signal that goes through the air. You might get a quick report on the television, but nobody can really, really predict the suddenness and the quickness of that storm. And you see, that was the case for those disciples as they found themselves out on the lake called Gennesaret. You see, Gennesaret, it was a lake that was known for its quick and sudden storms. As a matter of fact, geographically, Gennesaret was positioned between mountains. So what would happen is you could be out there on the lake one day, and everything was sunny. Everything was beautiful. Everything was clear. But what would happen is suddenly the wind would begin to blow. And because of where it was positioned, the wind would beat against the sides of the mountains. So eventually it would gather in moisture. And then all of a sudden, as you were there on your sunny day, amen, a funnel would suddenly appear over you. And all of a sudden, a storm would simply drop down upon the water. My God, have mercy. So one minute it was sunny, and the next minute it was stormy. One minute everything was fine, and another minute, amen, it was stormy. And that is the difficult thing about the things in between. It would be nice if Christians would call us a week early and let us know it was coming. It would be nice if storms and emergencies would inform us or send us an email and let them know that next week, Tuesday, you're going to find yourself going through something. But y'all know that's not how life is. My God, have mercy. One minute, everything could be sunny. And the next minute, you'll find yourself having to deal with a sudden storm. Things are going well, and the phone call comes in. Things are going well, and suddenly the doctor finds a spot on the x-ray. Things are going well, and suddenly the police call to tell you that your child is down at the station. Things are going well, and suddenly your spouse begins to flip out or deliver some bad news. Everything is going fine, but then the bottom falls out of the business. Everything was great, but then the exam on the test was lower than you expected. Everything was fine, and a relative suddenly becomes ill. The engine light on the car comes on. The family member has an accident, and all of a sudden, a violent storm just drops in. Has anybody in here ever had a storm drop in your life? Amen. You had all your ducks in order, and everything seemed to be wonderful, when all of a sudden, a storm dropped down. As a matter of fact, Matthew 8 and 23 and 24, the Bible says this about the storm. It says that without warning, a furious storm came up on the lake. So the waves swept over the boat. So not only were they in the storm, but they were under the storm.
There's a difference between being in a storm and under a storm. Because when you're in a storm, you still have your feet on the ground. You still have a level of control. But when you're under the storm, your feet have been cut out from under you. And you're under the influence of the wind and the waves that are around you. And you can tell when somebody is under a storm. Just listen to them talk. I'm under pressure. I'm under attack. I'm under so much stress. I'm under such a large load. My God, have mercy. Somebody in the house right now, you find yourself under a storm. But I come by with a word for you this morning, and that is that Jesus is still in control. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. Turn to somebody and tell them God is in control. Oh, hallelujah. I know the wind is blowing, but God is in control. I know you don't understand it, but God is in control. In spite of the rain, God is in control. In spite of the diagnosis, God is in control. In spite of the recession, God is in control. I just lost my job, but God is in control. No money in the bank, but God is in control. Broke, busted, and disgusted, but God is in control. Oh, glory to God. He is God all by himself, and he is still on the throne. Just like Isaiah said, I saw him high and lifted up and sitting on the throne. Somebody in here, give him a praise right now. Because God is in control. Oh, glory to God. Turn to three people. Tell them God is in control.
Oh, my God. Oh, hallelujah.
Glory to God. When man's not in control, he is in control. Is that not only is God in control during the things in between, but the second thing we need to understand is that Jesus is intimately involved in the things in between.
everybody in here is spiritual and anointed and appointed. Got a double dose of the Holy Ghost and early dose of the cover call and all that stuff. But has anybody in here ever gone through something and it felt like God was on vacation? Anybody? Yes. Testify a lot about that or nothing, you know, because we're not trying to make God look bad or anything, but sometimes I go through stuff and I pray, even fast, and God says nothing. I mean, I hit him on a cell and send him a text. He checked the phone and ain't no answer, no message, no. And it seems like he got me out on this journey. And I got far enough that I can't go back. It seems like he got me out here and left me all alone. Like I said, I know some of y'all can't relate to what I'm talking about because you're so anointed and everything. You just know what God is doing all the time, and there are no questions that ever enter into your mind, but I didn't come to talk to you anyhow. Listen, somebody in the house. He commissioned you and called you out and showed you what was going to look like, and you stepped out on faith, really like Abraham, not knowing where you're, all the details of where you're going, and you get out there in the middle of the water, and the waves are coming, the storm is there, the wind is blowing, the rain is falling, the thunder is rolling, the lightning is flashing, and there you are, and it seems like God had left you by. But let me tell you what I noticed. What I noticed about Jesus, and I've come to understand it about God, is that during a time of crisis, his demeanor seems to be in direct opposite of what he communicated to me about his heart. In other words, there's a difference between how he is acting on the outside as opposed to how he is feeling and concerned on the inside. I mean, I notice in the Word that when things got really stressful, now there are times when the Bible says he looked and he was moved with compassion. We read about the time when he stood outside of Lazarus' tomb and he wept before them. So he did show some outward display. But a lot of times when crisis came in Scripture, he just appeared to be so calm. Matter of fact, he seemed a little too cool for me sometimes when I'm going through stuff. I'm pacing the floor and he's chilling. I'm up at night worrying and wondering, and he's so calm. Matter of fact, look at a few examples. Matthew 14, the Bible says that Jesus was with his disciples and he told them to get into the boat and he went up to the mountain to pray. They get out on the water, and then sometime in the third watch of the night, everything is going crazy. There's a storm. And where's Jesus? The Bible says he comes walking, not running. Walking represents calm. That's why David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of a shadow of death. That's why the Hebrew boys, when Nebuchadnezzar looked in, he said, I see four men, they're loose and they're walking in the midst of the fiery furnace. Walking represents cool. You would have thought that he would have been in a hurry. You thought that he would be running out there, but he's walking on the water. Now remember that occasion when they bring him, that woman that was caught in adultery. Pharisees, the religious leaders, the church folk come and they grab him, and they bring him, her in front of him. They cast her down. They're trying to trap him. It's a moment of crisis. And Jesus just calmly turns and starts writing in the sand. Didn't stand in front of her to block him. Didn't yell, raise his voice. He just so calm. You remember when he stood before Pilate? Pilate's threatening to kill him. Said, hey man, don't you know who I am? I've got power. I can take your life. He said, look man, you have no clue who you're talking to. You can't take nothing from me. Son of man shall lay down his life. As a matter of fact, any power that you have came from my daddy. The Son of Man shall lay down his life. Glory to God, and I will take it back up again. I don't know about you, church, but he seemed so calm. You remember when he came to Lazarus' tomb? Amen. When the news reached him in Bethany concerning Lazarus, amen, that he, the one he loved was sick. Instead of getting up and running to Lazarus' aid, the Bible says that he stays there for 2 long days. He was just simply chilling. And by the time he got there, 4 days had passed by. Amen. I don't know about you, but sometimes he seems a little bit too calm when I'm going through something. Anybody in here know what I'm talking about? My God, have mercy. And that was the case here as the disciples find themselves dealing with the things in between. My God, can you see them on that boat? Hallelujah. The storm has just dropped down. The boat is, the Bible says the waters were beating against the boat. They're running around. They're casting, amen, off their goods probably and bailing water, amen, from the boat. The wind is blowing and everything is all going crazy. And where's Jesus? Bible says he was in the hinder part of the ship, sleep on a pillow, the nerve of him. You hear me? How can he not get nervous when I'm nervous? Here I am pacing the floor and he's sleeping on the ship. My God, here I am worrying about my situation, biting off my lean nails and pulling out my hair weave, and here he's got the nerve, oh, to be sleeping on the boat. My God, how dare his blood pressure not go up when mine is going up? How dare he not get worried and stressed out when I'm worried and stressed out? My God, he seems to be so very disconnected. And oh, Peter, oh my God, the disciples probably saw him in that position and they became insulted and they woke him up and said, Master, don't you even care that we perish? What they did not understand is that he cared. Do you hear me? But there's a difference between his demeanor and his heart. Hallelujah. He said, I'm intimately involved in your situation. How dare you suggest to me that I do not care? Now listen, before you start criticizing those disciples, you think about some of the questions you asked God when you were dealing with some stuff in between. Last time you decided to have yourself a pity party and you were the DJ, what were the questions? What about the questions you asked him when you were really going through? God, where are you? Anybody in here know what I'm talking about? Oh, Lord, why me? Anybody in here know what I'm talking about? Lord, I prayed and I prayed, and it seems as though the more I pray, the worse this situation is getting, and you're not answering. God, what is going on? Somebody in here know what I'm talking about in here. What's up with this, God? You're not even up there. You got me into this, and now you're acting like you do not care. And that's what was going through the minds of those disciples. They woke him up out of a sleep and said, Master, don't you even care? He don't have a 911 number. He don't have any ambulances sitting around in heaven. Oh, but he says, I'm God, and I am in control. Hallelujah. And though I'm not panicking, hallelujah, you need to understand that it does not mean that I do.
situation. That's why the Bible says, amen, to cast our care upon him, because he cares for you. Turn your neighbor and tell him he cares for you. That's right, he cares for you. My God, have mercy. When nobody else cares, he cares. When no one else understands, he understands. Oh, my God, when the wind is blowing, he cares for you. You're going through hell and high water, but thank God, he still cares. Hallelujah. It's not that he's not concerned about it, but he says, I'm God all by myself, and I'm not worried about the situation, because I'm still sitting upon the throne. Hallelujah. And he is in control of the situation. Somebody shout hallelujah in here.
But listen, not only is he intimately involved in the things in between, not only is he in control in the things in between, but thirdly and lastly, his word is relevant for the things in between. Touch somebody and tell them there's a word for you. Whatever you are facing this morning, God's got a word that he can speak directly into your situation. As a matter of fact, let me suggest to you that before you got in it, he had already spoke to it. Because he will not send you into anything without giving you a word of conception and a word of completion. My God, have mercy. Listen to me. In other words, he said, listen, before you started out, I gave you a word about that situation. My God, and my word is still relevant. I come by to tell somebody today that you need to understand that even in the midst of your storm, that the word of God still works. Touch somebody and tell them it still works. That's right, it still works. If you'll work it, amen, it'll work. Hallelujah. My God, his word is still relevant for the time in which you find yourself in. You see, I found out about Jesus is that he does not waste his words. His words are so powerful that when he clears his mouth to speak, what he says will come to pass. Amen. Glory to God. As the Bible says in John 1:1, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And then the scripture says in verse 14 that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. So when you look at Jesus, what you simply have is the full embodiment of God's word. Hallelujah. My God, the same word that was in the beginning that created all things, in him, hallelujah, was that word, the same word that the psalmist talked about. Psalm 33:6, when he said, by the word of God of the Lord were the heavens made. The same word in Psalm 103:2, he said, bless the Lord, and all ye his angels and his seven spirit that do his commandment, hearkening unto the voice of his word. Psalm 104:20, he sent his word, and he came and delivered them from their destruction. Psalm 119:8-9, forever, O Lord, is thy word settled in the heavens. My God, Psalm 103, I will wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope. Hallelujah. So Jesus was the full embodiment of the word. And whenever he opened up his mouth again, what he said was going to happen.
Amen.
Oh, yes.
So he arises out of his sleep.
Yes.
They said, Master, do you even care that we perish? Notice what he does. He clears his throat, speaks to the situation, and says, peace, be still. I know a lot of y'all are a little too young to remember, but they used to be this commercial when we were growing up about a stockbroker by the name of E.F. Hutton. Remember that commercial? Well, there used to be this commercial, and maybe they were at a tennis match or something, big crowd of people, and they were all cheering, and the game was going on, and the people were in the stands watching the ball go back and forth. And two guys would be in the stands in the middle, and they'd be talking to each other. One would turn to the other and says, "You know, my insurance broker, E.M. Hutton, says." Then all of a sudden, the ball would stop. Anybody remember? People would stop cheering, and everybody would just get quiet and turn their ear toward him. And then the voice in the background would say, "When E.M. Hutton speaks, people listen, right?" Well, listen to me. When Jesus speaks, hallelujah, the one who created all that there is, whenever he opens up his mouth, all of nature, every storm, every sickness, every disease, every situation that you are facing in between has to listen, hallelujah. Glory to God. So when he opened up his mouth and spoke to the wind and the waves and said, "Peace, be still," hallelujah, they bowed at his feet like a dog to its master, hallelujah, and the wind ceased from blowing. Glory to God. And the Bible says they looked at one another, hallelujah, and they marveled at what they had seen. And notice what happens after the storm had been stilled. Jesus turns to the disciples and rebukes them. Say, "Hey, why did you not have any faith?" Why would he rebuke them? I mean, they were in the middle of a storm, and they did have enough faith to wake him up. They had that much faith that they understood that if this storm was going to be stopped, that the one who had the possibility of doing it was on the boat and needed to be awakened. I mean, he wasn't angry at them because they had broke his sleep. Because even though he was housed in a physical flesh, he is still the God who never sleeps nor slumbers. So it couldn't have been that, but then I got to look at him and said, "Well, why would he rebuke them?" The reason why he rebuked them is because they woke him up to speak to something he had already spoken to. You didn't hear what I said. They woke him up to speak to something he had already spoken to. When they were on the land, he said, "Let us pass over to the other side." So he gave them a beginning word. Let us pass. And an ending word, over to the other side. So what those disciples, amen, should have had, and what Jesus desired for them to have, was the kind of faith that says, "God, you spoke to it at the very beginning, and regardless of what happened in between, oh my God, everything is going to be all right." So in other words, when the wind started blowing, they should have looked at one another and said, "You know the wind's blowing, but he said we're going to the other side." Oh my God. Oh, look at that wave. Oh, but that's okay. He said we're going to the other side. You know they're beating against the ship. Oh my God, it feels like the ship might turn over. No, it ain't turning over, because he said we're going to the other side. Oh my God, I just got a bad report, and the doctor told me I'm not going to make it. Oh, but he said I'm going to make it, because I'm going over to the other side. I just lost my job, and I don't have two nickels to rub together, but that's all right. He said my God shall supply all of my need according to his riches and glory, and we're going over to the other side. High five your neighbor and tell him we're going over. We're going over. Oh my God, have mercy. Hallelujah. He said in other words, if I spoke it from the very beginning, whatever I have to do to get you to the other side, we are going to get there. Oh, glory to God. Turn to somebody and tell them we're going to get there. Hallelujah.
sister. For if we never had a problem, we'd never know that you could solve them. We'd never know what faith in your word can do. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned that I can depend upon his word. Oh, hallelujah. Father, we bless you. We glorify you. We thank you right now. We thank you. Thank you for that promise. Thank you for that visionary. Thank you for that vision. But God, even though we thank you for the conception and the birthing, and we thank you for the completion, but we lift our hands to say thank you. For the things in between. Thank you, God, for being in control. Thank you that when I felt like everything was lost and everything was out of control, that you were in control. Thank you, God, that you promised never to leave me nor forsake me, that you walked with me, Emmanuel, standing beside me in the midst of the storm. I pray right now, God, that you would remind somebody today of that word you spoke at the beginning. We thank you that your promises are yea and amen to we which believe. Now bless your sons and daughters right now. Minister to them, Father. Speak a word. Peace. Speak to the things in between. Those things between point A and point B. Now be glorified in this house. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Maybe I close every head bowed. There's somebody in the house right now, first of all. It's Jesus. Is Jesus aboard your ship this morning? Or are you like one of the other ships, you are sailing across the waters of life without the Savior on board? Is there somebody in the house that would say, preacher, I do not know him as my Lord and Savior. I'm not asking you about church membership. I'm not asking you about water baptism. I want to know, do you know him? Is he your Lord? Have you been born again? Jesus wants to ride on the ship of your life today. And if you are here right now and you say, preacher, I want to invite him in. I try to control my own destiny and control my own situation and control my own habits. But I found out that I cannot, and I want to invite the one who is able to steer my ship in the proper direction to take over this morning. If you're here and you're not saved and you're backslidden and need to be restored, in this Back to God conference, the first day, are you ready to come back to him? With every eye closed, every head bowed, if I'm talking to you right now, would you just slip your hand in the air so I can pray for you now? In the name of Jesus, yes, God bless you. Somebody else? Yes, God bless you too. Somebody else? Come on, that's right. God bless you. Somebody else? Yes, Lord, God bless you. Somebody else? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God bless you, sir. Somebody else. We're waiting on you. Thank you, Lord. Now you raise your hand. Would you do one more thing? Would you just slip yourself in the nearest aisle and just meet me at this altar? Don't worry about what people are thinking. This is between you and God. Come on. We've all had to take this walk before. Come on. That's right. God bless you as you're coming. God bless you as you're coming. That's right. God bless you as you're coming. Still waiting on you. Come on. That's right. That's right. God bless you. Don't be ashamed. Don't be afraid this morning. God loves you just like you are. Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Through it all.
so out of control that I become discouraged and depressed. What I need is I need for God to speak peace into my storm, to speak peace into my personal life. What I need is I need an anointing that's going to get me through whatever it is I'm dealing with until I get to the other side. If there's somebody that I'm talking to, just lift your hand up. I want to pray for you today. Where are you? Where are you? Where are you? Thank you, Lord. You who lifted those hands, just step out and meet me at this altar. We're going to believe God with you right now. There is a peace that passes understanding. There is a strength and a joy that God can give in the midst of struggle, in the midst of mourning, in the midst of depression and discouragement. There's a God that says, I am the lifter of your head. Come on. And we realize that we're all sinners. Everybody in this house, we've all messed up. We've fallen short of what God wants us to be. So once we recognize that, we ask God's forgiveness. Ask Him to come into our lives, and He takes over and He says, listen, you just confess it. He said, I'm so faithful, I'm so fair that I'll forgive you of everything that you've ever done. I'll take over your life. If you're ready to do that this morning, that's all it takes. It's a simple surrender to Him. So I tell you what we're going to do. I'm going to pray a prayer for you first. And then what I want you to do is I want you to simply repeat a prayer with me. As a matter of fact, this congregation, we love you so much, we're all going to repeat the very same prayer with you to support you right now. And believe God as you invite Him into your life. Do you believe those things I just shared with you this morning? about Christ and realize who you are, let's just bow our heads right now. We're going to have a quick word of prayer. I want to pray for you right now. God, thank you for your sons and your daughters that are at this altar right now. Lord, I thank you that you covered them, you preserved their lives, because we know that the enemy would have liked to have taken them out before this moment. But you covered them, you protected them, you watched over them, and even allowed them to be here this morning. That means you have purpose for them, you have a plan, you have destiny. So now, God, as we bow our heads to pray in just a moment, we realize that the enemy is fighting, trying to bring doubt, trying to blind them from the truth, but we bind the plan of the enemy right now. And we pray, God, that as we pray, the light of the gospel would shine into their hearts even right now. Lord, that you will make yourself more real to them than anything they've ever experienced. And we thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name. So, God, we bow our heads and we repeat this prayer. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus, your only Son, to die for my sins. I believe that he was crucified, but he rose on the third day. Lord, I realize I'm a sinner. I've messed up. I've fallen short of what you want me to be. I ask you to forgive me, God. Come into my heart. Set me free from sin. And help me to serve you from this day forward. I thank you for hearing me. And I believe that I am saved because I've asked it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I just begin to thank him right now. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I tell you what I want you to do. I just want you to spend a few moments at this altar just asking and reaching out to God and just talking to God. Some people are going to come behind you just to help you right now. Amen. Just begin to talk to God and let him touch you right now. You who come right now for special needs. You're dealing with the things in between. You might be discouraged or depressed or whatever the case is. I want you to begin to reach out right now. Notice what those disciples said after he spoke to the wind and the waves. They looked at each other and they marveled. And in an act of worship, in a sense, they said, "What manner of man is this? That even the wind and the sea obey him." I just want you to begin to uplift him and glorify God right now. There is deliverance in your praise. There is even a touch in your praise.
We're together again.
Thank you. I've seen a lot of faces. There have been times I felt so all alone. But in my lonely hours, those precious lonely hours, Jesus let me know I was His own.
I've learned to trust in God.